Is the universe an isolated system?
Is the universe an isolated system? You know, can we even talk about the universe as a whole? Presumably, yes, if you actually mean yes, everything in the universe is, you know, if you literally mean universe is everything there is, then...
It seems tautologically the case.
Right. However, another question is, does the universe as a whole obey the sorts of laws that we usually think of as applicable to isolated systems? And here's why this is a genuine question, is it might be that, okay, for like relatively small systems that we can actually isolate, are the physics we apply to isolated systems applies, but when things are big enough, that doesn't actually apply. And what I mean by that is, in quantum mechanics, what usually, when you're asking, is the universe an isolated system, what you usually mean is, it evolves according to whatever the appropriate analog of the Schrödinger equation is, and that can be represented by a family of unitary operators, and that, you know, preserves Hilbert space norm, and so it can't start out in, say, you know, a small subspace of Hilbert space and go any bigger, right? But people who take dynamical collapse theories seriously think that actually this isolated Schrödinger evolution that we apply to sort of systems in the lab that we isolate is actually an idealization and not quite right. And that if you have systems that meet certain criteria, either they have enough particles or, you know, they involve displacements of large masses, then actually the physical law is a different one that isn't the law that we usually think of as isolated, and in fact mathematically mimics the sort of laws that we use for systems that aren't isolated. As you know, because I know you've talked to people about this, there are dynamic collapse theories, right, which modify the usual Schrödinger equation. And basically, you know, the origin of those was, you know, people are studying evolution of non-isolated systems and saying, okay, here's what happens to the state of the system if it's, say, in contact with the heat bath or something like that. And then saying, well, let's just imagine that something of this form or a similar form actually is the fundamental law. Okay. In which case it'll still be tautological, if that's right, it'll still be tautologically. If that's the case, it'll still be a tautology that the universe is isolated, but it might be that the way the universe as a whole evolves is as if it's continually be monitored by some external measurer. Yeah.
I'm a Roe partner, and I want to tell you about Roe Sparks, a 2-in-1 prescription treatment for men, for guys who want better performance. Roe Sparks dissolves under the tongue, hitting the bloodstream faster than old school pills. Once the medication dissolves, Roe Sparks works in 15 minutes on average. No more waiting when the mood is right. Plus, Roe Sparks' dual-action formula contains tadalafil, staying active in your system for up to 36 hours. You don't stay hard that whole time. It's just when aroused, your body can respond, ready for round after round. Roe connects guys with a medical provider, 100% online, no awkward in-person conversations, no waiting rooms. If approved, treatment ships directly to your door. If prescribed, new sexual health patients get $15 off your first order of Sparks on a recurring plan. Connect with a provider at ro.co/toe to find out if prescription Roe Sparks are right for you. That's ro.co/toe for $15 off your first order. Compounded drugs are permitted to be prescribed under federal law, but are not FDA approved and do not undergo FDA safety, effectiveness, or manufacturing review. For safety information, go to ro.co/safety-info.
Okay, my other funny question is, it's often said that at some point we'll reach the heat death of the universe and that we won't be able to do anything, even if we're supposing that we're around or whatever is our descendants.
Yeah.
Now, do you imagine that to be the case? Because if we're thinking in terms of a resource theory, right, then I could imagine that there would be certain questions that would be more important to us, that would be different to us, to whatever our descendants are. Maybe they are able to utilize a system with more precision.
Absolutely. Like the way we actually calculate entropy is, and this is something that's not often emphasized in textbooks, is relative to a certain set of parameters that we think we're interested in or we're going to manipulate. And for example, if I want to calculate the entropy of some standard volume of gas, the question is, do I count samples of gas with different isotope ratios differently? And as long as I'm only dealing with things chemically, it doesn't matter like how much of my oxygen is one isotope and how much it doesn't. If I'm dealing with nuclear reactions or if I've got some way to separate out things according to their mass, then that actually might be something. And so I might want to include that in the entropy calculations. So there's a sense in which entropy is relative to, what is it you're going to manipulate. However, when people are talking about the heat death, no matter what it is that you want to do, the natural tendency for things is towards left to themselves is towards diminished ability to do that. Right. So eventually, and it was really in the 19th century that people started talking about the heat death of the universe. Kelvin himself wrote a article called "On a Universal Tendency Towards Dissipation of Energy." And so what is going to happen if things just keep going is the sun's going to burn out and pretty much anything that we want to do here on Earth, like no matter what your goals are or your means of manipulation, it involves some kind of entropy difference that ultimately traces from the fact that on one side of us we've got this high temperature source of low entropy energy, and on the other side we've got this low temperature empty space that we can radiate stuff back to. And eventually that's going to run out. Even if you have more subtle ways of manipulating things, eventually everything's going to decay into black holes. And eventually, no matter what your goals are, and no matter what means you have manipulation, eventually things are going to run out and just stay that way forever, unless Roger Penrose is right about his conformal cyclical cosmology. When after that happens, then things get restarted. So that's true. But honestly, we're talking like absurdly long timescales, like billions and billions of years. So I think we should be more worried about what are things going to be like for people on Earth in the next few centuries. Right. That is something that we can do something about, right? And what's going to happen on this timescale of millions and billions of years? It's actually hard for us to wrap our heads around it. So, some people find this, heat death of the universe, they sort of depressing, and sometimes people say, okay, this makes everything meaningless. Well, you know what, you've known most of your life you're going to die eventually, right? And you've got a certain limited amount of time to do stuff with, right? And do what you can with it while you have it. Make the best of the time that you have.
Hi, everyone. Hope you're enjoying today's episode. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.